So ladies and gentlemen, now I invite Mr. Kapil Maheshwari, he's the CEO of Hinduja Renewables, to give his presentation. Are you ready, Mr. Kapil, for this? Okay.
My name is Kapil Maheshwari. I'm CEO for Hinduja Renewables. Just a brief background, I'm in solar field for almost 13, 14 years. Started my career as a design engineer in US and in solar. So many things have been talked, and even I have been speaking on various conferences on solar, capex, opex, rooftop, utility, price trends, etc., etc. I think it's now time that we go on, move to some other things which are looking more futuristic rather than talking about the same kind of things. Because even in some of the EQ conferences, I have spoken on rooftop, utility system, what are the challenges, what are the opportunities. So I thought, let me share with you some of the things which we have been working on for almost a year's time. And of course, this is not the part where our work summary is, but just an overview of, because energy storage would be the factor which will drive renewable towards 100 gigawatt mission. I mean, there's no way we can do 100 gigawatt, even if as in solar industry, we are ready to do. We have seen globally that what happens with California duck curve, with various other things. So unless we have storage in various forms, and not only maybe batteries, but other forms, it is very difficult that we will be able to get to that mark. And of course, we've started, maybe there are off-grid application, telecom towers, maybe there are microgrids wherein batteries are used, but now it's time that it's now at a scale where we can use it in most of our systems as well. And like the way pricing trends have been spoken about solar panels, pricing trends, the most recent pricing trends would be on the lithium ion batteries, where globally these are being talked about, to how the pricing trends are coming. What's the readiness for companies in India? I mean, at least in recent conferences, I have met at least 10 startups who want to set up lithium ion battery packs in India. So where do we stand on that? Let me just start with what's the overall energy technology looks like. I mean, you have various factors to what are the various storage types. Is hydrogen related, where you want to use hydrogen as a fuel? So it could be in cars, it could be, so let me just divide the presentation. In this presentation, I'm not speaking on the electric vehicle front of it, because that will be the major contributor for the battery technology. Stationary storage, what I am covering here, which is largely matches with our conference agenda today, which is renewable plus in storage. But the major contribution would come on this from the electric vehicles. Then there are mechanical storage, electrochemical, where we have been talking on the battery technology, electrical and thermal. So like supercapacitors, magnetic energy storage, what are these is you can store a lot of energy in this and discharge it in seconds. So let's say primarily useful in a bus which wants to get charged very soon on a route, or maybe in train. Such kind of application, supercapacitors. Then we have batteries, where it's in between in terms of its power rating and the amount of discharge it can give. So it can, you know, give you in discharge from couple of minutes to couple of hours. And various technologies could be lithium ion, lead acid. I mean, we still have a market in India for lead acid of around, let's say, 8-10 gigawatt hours. But does that, you know, whatever said and done, we now realize that this, unless there is an significant improvement in efficiency and energy densities and the cycles in lead acid technology or advanced lead acid, lithium ion seems to be more promising. Then you have technologies like hydrogen fuel cells, etc., where you can store a lot of power and discharge it in a couple of hours. On a lithium ion, if we focus, what is the basic technology is making the electrolytes, I mean, anode and cathode. So I don't see any company where we have an advanced stage in India to make anode cathode. Largely anode materials are graphite and lithium titanium oxide. Graphite is a popular material, and we have significant reserves of graphite in India. I mean, Graphite India and Bangalore is doing significantly well because lithium ion is gaining more popularity. So in terms of cost and lifetime, both it is okay, but LTO in terms of cost and lifetime, both it is high, but at the same time, energy density is low. On the cathode material, you have various cathode material. The idea, I mean, I cannot cover what are the various chemistries here, but just to give you in brief as to what are the various technologies used and its application. On a chemistry, then it can take, I think I'll not be allowed to speak more than 10 minutes, so I would not. So LCO, LMO, NMC, LFP, NCA, so let's say these are lithium, cobalt, oxide, manganese. So these are the material used in cathode technologies, and you would see the various energy density. So where the efforts are, the whole idea of efforts which is moving in the battery technology right now is to increase energy density. So from the same weight, you have more watt-hours, so you can use it for the most time. Reduce the cost and increase the lifetime. So if we can achieve all of these three, that will be the chemistry which will look more futuristic. So largely NMC and NCA are used because they provide a mix of all three in terms of energy density, cost and lifetime. And the lifetime, I would also say, is dependent on how many cycles of discharge and charge it can take. So that will also be quite important for the lifetime. So these are various technology and their comparison. You would see the LTO efficiencies are very high. They can operate for a longer, I mean, they can operate for a very high temperature range. I mean, it's quite important in India, and that's the reason some of the commercial buses look for an LTO technology, because the ambient temperature could be very high, and that's good if these batteries work at a high ambient temperature with the same amount of efficiency it can. Normally in battery efficiency figures, what you see from 93% to 97%, these are figures when you are operating the batteries at around 25-27 degrees centigrade. So as the temperature increases, there is a derating, like the way you have all been knowing, something similar to your solar panels. Most batteries of this would be with a depth of discharge of 80% define their lifetime. C rate defines how fast you can discharge the battery. So let's say 1C could be that you can do it in hour, C by 4 that you can discharge the entire battery in 15 minutes. Cycle life is how many times you can charge and discharge. Most of these batteries are toxic in nature. So we are still talking of battery technology, etc., and where people have actually started working on how do you recycle these batteries. So let's say an example, when it all started 2007-8, when most, or maybe I would say a little before also, 2006-7, when China started making solar panel at a scale 1 gigawatt and above, and 10 such suppliers were given aids from the government to do such a thing, and they were taking all these smaller 200 to 500 megawatts of German supplier and taking that as a scale. So something similar is happening in energy storage market there as well. So right now, if you talk, we have approximately 55% of battery market available in China. They have very promising technologies, and approximately 65% of the entire electric vehicle market is in China. While we are only talking of gigawatt scale factories, gigawatt hour factories to be coming for battery storage in India, they already are at scale where they could be reaching around 180 to 200 gigawatt hours. And there are at least six companies which are planning in somewhere in between 20 to 30 and maybe in future around 50 gigawatt hour kinds of line in 3 to 5 years. We have no gigawatt hour line present in India. And looking at the investment size, I wouldn't say that if you want to make cells in India, unless you're planning a 1 gigawatt hour with an investment size of nearly $150 to $200 million, it doesn't make sense to do a cell production at a capacity of 50 megawatt hours or 100 megawatt hours. You will never be able to achieve that scale, and so is the cost. So when you, I mean, So where we will be still be making energy packs. So I think I've covered some of this on the technology. You would see that with various chemistries, the dimensions to look are how is the specific energy, how is the safety of this, how is the performance, lifespan and cost. And various technologies have advantage and disadvantage. So just to explain you this chart, I'll just compare NC and NMC. So let's say the specific power, if you take as an example, NMC is can accommodate less specific power compared to NCA. And in the same way, NCA is less safe compared to NMC battery. So safety is largely driven by how you are able to separate both the electrolytes, what kind of separator material you use. In any case, are there possibilities that a fire can be there or not? So where we are presently is popular technologies from LCO, NMC, LFPs. Then we are moving towards in 3 to 10 years towards some solid state batteries, high voltage, lithium silicon. And then the other electrolyte, let's use air. So there's only lithium or maybe lithium magnesium and air in this. So 10 years down the line, those chemistries also could be very popular. Now, why do you feel in a renewable market it is so important that we've started right now, we've started seeing where when the parks are coming up in size of 500 megawatt to 1 gigawatt, they'll always be in time of grid outages. Grid is not able to take that power. So and policies are in process where utilities as well as the developers would be asked to put some amount of storage at the plant boundary as well as at the substation. So what are the application if you see in terms of using the energy storage? So first is in renewable integration, where you would see that they can be used for 3 to 4 hours, maybe a couple of seconds as well, but largely in range of 3 to 4 hours where you can supply power from that. So when we spoke about solar wind hybrid systems to increase PLF, or when we spoke about 24/7 renewable, this is an important shift. Then on a consumer side, when demand chain management happen, you have TOD charges, etc. This is an important aspect to look at. Transmission and distribution side, an upgrade to the grid. And on an ancillary services, it does provide support for load shaving, frequency regulation, voltage support. So all that dips. I mean, in Europe, when you are setting up a plant within storage, people are getting incentives for in frequency regulation. In US, you have watched which are synchronized with the frequency, so you can't afford, like in India, we can afford. So that way. What are the market drivers? I mean, renewable integration will not be the most important market driver to this, but electric vehicle adoption would drive, certainly drive the energy storage market. Other things could be telecom towers, diesel replacement in those. Falling prices of PVs and batteries would drive. I mean, the way we are seeing solar energy is available cheaper, at the same time batteries also, the trend is moving towards $400-$500 kilowatt hours to more prominent figures of 200, sub 200 figures. I mean, in US people are talking now on a $100 kilowatt hour, this thing. What is that we have done in last 2 years in this? The first project in Andaman Nicobar, 20 megawatt, 28 hour megawatt hour battery tender by NLC, which is already done. NTPC and Netra unit is coming up. So there are few things which we've already done in this, which are up and running in telecom towers, etc. It's in, people are now moving from lead acid to advanced lead acid or lithium ion. What the proposed thing is, largely in SEZs and smart cities, make a complete solar smart city along with batteries. There are various other government agencies who are coming up with energy storage. Most of these tenders you would be seeing in electric vehicle, but on a utility, and this thing also is coming. So there are still some challenges. Still the cost is high. So the short-term impact of that would be significantly high. The adoption would be lower. So that is one thing. Lack of policy framework. I mean, we still don't have policies. How do we do a robust policy to for adoption of this? And impact of this would be a little bit on the short term, but medium, long term, I think that will be taken care. An improvement in supply and grid reliability. I mean, we don't have suppliers here in India for such a thing. There are a lot of talks where most Indian industrial houses wants to come and set up factories, as well as most systems are being talked about now with energy storage, electric vehicle, of course. There are tenders coming now and then. And on a long term, the improvement of supply and grid reliability would be very high if we consider this. Of course, commercial industrial segment remains the most attractive for energy storage, because rooftop, you people who want to do in 24/7 100% renewable RE100 aim, it makes a lot of sense, especially that you have everything covered in that. Happy to take questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kapil, for yes. In fact, Anand is kind enough to allow everybody to extend for a couple of more minutes also. So that's fine. Well, thank you very much for sharing something which the now the globally people are talking about, which is energy storage, and particularly when the world has committed for converting their all their transport vehicles to electric vehicles. I think this is something where I feel like we must look into this, study it properly. And since the Mr. Patwari, who is the president of the Gujarat Chamber of Commerce, is here, I suggest Mr. Patwari to take up this as a trade body and organize an event where we can like invite the different people, people from a company who develop different technology on energy storage, and particularly which are useful for electric vehicle. It's not only electric vehicle. In fact, now you know all the household applications. In fact, I've been to one of the international conference sometimes back, and where the people are talking about, though you have a grid, people are talking about battery with every household appliances you have, your refrigerator, your TV, everything. You know that people are they have developed, which is running on battery with the super capacitor, so that charging time of that capacitor. In fact, I've been to one of nanotechnology conference in Bangalore. And I was really surprised that the way India is working in nanotechnology. Particularly, I was fortunate to meet Dr. Rao, and he is a person who developed this supercapacitor 20 years ago. I mean, he just published the paper 20 years ago, and it's still there in the public domain. And he was happy that one of English company, they produce this supercapacitor last year based on his paper. So I think the India is a front runner in this kind of application also. The major challenge was for the energy storage, particularly with the battery, was the cost, the charging time, and the maintenance. These are the three major factors. So I think the world is addressing this, and the solar will have a new turn. In fact, it's not that the solar is one of component in this, but solar will have a major role to play when it this actually happens. So Mr. Patwali, if you can take it up to bring this technology and the technologies to Gujarat, and so that the entrepreneurs in Gujarat are quite, they are smart enough to take up this. Now I invite Mr. Anil Vishwakarma, who is the head engineering renewable energy Adani Green, to deliver his address.
Here I'll be talking about the utility projects of renewable energy in India. Before that, Adani Green Energy Limited, it's basically one of the group companies of Adani, and developing in wind projects as well as solar. This financial year we have a target of put up of 2000 megawatt. And we have achieved till date around 1218 megawatt till date, and others are in a different phase of commissioning and mostly located in Karnataka, South India. North India, we have already completed most of the projects. We have also footprint in the wind also, where we have already completed, commissioned 66 megawatt, and 150 megawatt is in pipeline, which we are going to complete in next 6 months. We have signed a MOU with the Rajasthan and about 10,000 megawatt to develop a solar park. We have already currently doing Bhadla solar park of 500 megawatt, and we have already initiated 1500 megawatt Fatehgarh solar park. So we have already got the connectivity of 400 kV lines, 750 each from the RVPN as well as PGCIL. And we have a great in-house engineering capability. We have a well-managed project management team. We are delivering the all projects. This is all the Adani Green. Let us, I will now, the utility projects in India, the scenario. So basically all the, these are the grid interactive renewable power projects under National Solar Mission, mainly through the private investment driven with tariff policy regimes. As you know, we have been hearing that we have installed capacity of around 60 gigawatt out of total thermal wind entire generation of 330 gigawatt. And we have been also hearing that we have a target of 175 gigawatt renewable power by year 2022, where 100 gigawatt is only solar. We have to complete by 2022. These are the all awarded through the SECI, CPSU, state through bidding and under the various stage of implementation. I will basically speak about the challenges we face in utility projects, like grid connectivity varies across, apart from the park, where the we need to take non-park, where we have to take the land as well as grid connectivity. Those are the major challenges. Apart from the park, and different, all the states have the different policies. If I talk about the mainly like Telangana and Andhra, where you have a connectivity, you'll get it, but the all this, like even if your plant end, the entire design has to be approved from the utilities. So that was the major bottleneck is there, where as compared to the north, where you have a full design of your own in the in plant. So these are the major challenges. And if you this switch yard, if you are talking about the switch yard in the south, like Telangana, and there every this small switch yard is there, because you have a 30 megawatt, 50 megawatt plants are there. So for that you don't need a big switch yard, you have only transformer and the line. So there they, we have to, because the Telangana policy is such that you have to put a SAS system, substation automation system, where it is, that is not justified there. But these are the challenges which we are facing. Like these two small switch yard, where we can do it with the conventional sort of things. Then the tariff metric, it is a very, it's a totally uniform in the entire state. As per the SECI and the CA guidelines, where we have a main and check and standby metering. It has to be at the remote location, interface point, where all these two will be separate there itself. But the state has a different policies, where they have certain, the plant end one will be there and other end another will be there. But as per the SECI and NTPC, the all the and CA guidelines, it, that metering location has to be a remote location. But there are also some issues are there with, because putting this the metering in the remote locations, the bay, the standby location, standby metering and the main and check, the bay length will get increases. So because of that, there is a restrictions on the, on that. So some states are allowing, some states are not allowing. But see, we is the, all the SECI projects, we have to follow the SECI guidelines. So they are enforcing us to put that remote end also. Whatever the line length, whatever the bay length will increase. So that is a challenge we are taking up with the state utilities and getting it done, but it has a challenge. Then the reactive power requirement. This is something which we have a grid where most of the plants, thermal power plants and others are like rotating machines where the grid frequencies are monitored. So, but in solar, there is no such frequencies and all. So it's a basically static type of devices. And when these are keep on adding in the grid, so there is a misbalancing of the reactive power. So a state like Karnataka, they have clearly stated that every 20 megawatt, you have to provide plus minus 4 MVAR reactive power. So this is the guideline they have issued. But what industry practice is that we are using the inverter capability, power capability, where you have a cushion of that reactive power, which is being utilized entire across the industry, but the witness is being not done. Somewhere it is done, but somewhere not, it is not done. So if you see, if it is really, we have to take the reactive power management from the inverter, then you losing your reactive power as well, because the inverter is rated for unity power factor, the capacity is rated for unity power factor. But if this reactive power implementation is there, then depending on the grid, you have to this 0.95 and 95 lagging factor you have to maintain. If you go like that, then you are definitely going to lose the active power. But in overseas, there is different phenomena. There we have called PSS, where this is a power system stabilizer, which controls, you have a static var compensator. Depending on the grid, it will take capacitor as well as inductor, so that they maintain the power factor. Other is like telemetry requirement. That is also, it's a totally non-informed entire across the state. Like in Karnataka, they don't want your real time of generation data of the plant, and they need only remote end data. And other like in Telangana and Andhra, they need your plant data. And that also not through the like GPRS and other GPRS based, because not the most of the data is on GPRS based, but they have strictly on the if it is a 132 kV line, then you have to provide through the PDS based forte panel or PLCC or lease line. Lease line also they have a clear cut guidelines that you have to provide 132 kV and below 132 kV, 33 kV you have to provide lease line. But in northern state and all, they have a flexibility. It's a lease, you can provide data or lease line or either from GPRS also. So this is the non-uniformity across the India we are facing here. Now the features of LVRT, which is now being made mandatory in inverter as well as now wind converter as well. So this is also a challenge in the wind industry, where you have to, wind converter has to made a LVRT compliant. There is also a provision of control features from the SLDC, where they can control the entire power through the set point. It's a basically grid security warrants, they will control it from there itself. If something you have to 100 megawatt plant, they have to reduce 10%, they can reduce 10 megawatt, but not in for single inverter or single wind machine. They can, it will proportionally affect all machines. So this is the where it will come implemented as per the ICC code. Now this, I'll talk about the how the technology selections is going to affect our the plants. We have a fixed AC capacity in our plant. If I'll talk about the 50 megawatt plant, it's nothing but 50 megawatt AC. But the DC capacity is keep on varying. Earlier, if I'll talk about the tracker, where I can achieve 20% loading with the same 30% loading in the fixed or seasonal tilt, the same generation I can achieve. So now the industry, we are seeing the loading is keep on increasing. Now we are loading up to the 47 or 50%. because the falling module prices and the cost of tracker and all, if you compare, so then there will be loading in a DC side, there is a clipping losses. But that also take together, there is advantage on that. Loading of the DC in inverters. So, other is like central versus string. There also we have, because the land profile and all, if you will talk about the advantage of a string, definitely it has a multi MPPT where there will be a lot of undulations in the plant. If I have a central inverter, if I talk about the 5 megawatt block, the ACB is connected around that, have a different length, so there is a voltage drop. So the single MPPT has a certain disadvantage over the generation of the solar generation. And string, because of the multi MPPT features, each string, small size, have multiple MPPT, even if the more undulations will be there, it will generate more and more power. Of course, there is a certain lacuna is there, but it will fit in the this Indian environment, because the land, this across the India, your land is not flat, so definitely string utilization comes, it has more impact on the generation. So the technology selection again, if 1500 volt DC system, it has impact, it has a certain benefits like low losses, and it has a BOS cost is also less, but it this 15 volts all equipment has to be first commoditized. It will definitely come into near future, and and we industry will prefer solar park where the land is at one place, the common infrastructures are there, and you need not to bother about the connectivity and land. So definitely a solar park will be welcome, and we have to move on that direction also. Storage, as my colleague told me, of the storage, that will play a major role in like in a solar power plant where the PV is smoothing. There is two issues are there with the storage. That one is like PV smoothing, where the clouds will come, certain there is a drop of the generation, so the battery will immediately for the 2 minutes and all, it will take care of that part. And the other is a load balancing, where you have a demand and that supply gap is there, where it can be more useful. This I think I have completed. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Vishwakarma.